calling the cubing machine, which is a small rigging machine to convert waste paper into cubes used to be burned together with biomass, together with coal. Here, the briquetting machine, where you can convert biomass to bigger pieces. This one can easily be mixed with coal. Here is a system where we have coal and paper briquets mixed. It's all been pre-mixed. That means there's some pre-mixing is needed, some additional costs, additional work. Here's the system. Again, it's pre-mixed. A dump load. Dump. I consider it a much better solution. Something very important here is the refraction. If you have biomass and you have moisture in the biomass, then you need to evaporate the water before you can start making use of burning the biomass. And you need refraction for this. The refraction will mirror heat energy into the fuel and evaporate the water. Once the water has been evaporated, you start to evaporate the volatiles, the gases in the fuel, and burn. Secondary air is needed for this, and then the last part of the combustion is the fixed carbon in the fuel that will burn at the end of the break like this. This here, co-firing in water tube model, where we're talking about coal and wood shavings. Coal is being fed into the boiler, gravity feeding into a tube where we have the thermic ray feeding the coal. And then here we have a silo, cell sluice, a fan feeding the wood shavings into the boiler. And then the wood shavings will probably burn, for most of it will burn here, suspended in the flue gas. If they're bigger pieces, they will end up on the grate and be burnt together with the coal while the grate is moving. This here, up to shavings, you remember from the fuel preparation, we saw rice hulls and wood shavings are not that much shaken. So here you could burn on a similar setup, you could use rice hulls, you can use wood shavings, you could use, if you have corn cobs passed through a hammering mill, so you have it like dust, then you could use the same setup. Something you have to be aware of when you do like this, that is the boiler capacity. You feed in coal and you feed in biomass, but the caloric value on the biomass is much less than on the coal. And because you feed different fuels, you don't get different size of the boiler. The flue gas velocity that the boiler has been designed for is not changing because you change the fuel. That means the amount of flue gas cannot be bigger, and you have less energy in the flue gas from biomass. That means boiler capacity will go down. I was working on a project in Thailand where we were planning to mix coal and biomass, but the project stopped because the power plant had an agreement about a minimum supply of power to the public grid. If they couldn't perform according to the contract, they would lose a lot of money, so they had to give up and continue burning coal. Here another type of stoker, a spreader stoker, where you are throwing the coal into the boiler across the furnace, and then you have a traveling rake burning whatever ends up on the traveling rake and then feeding the ash to an ash hopper. But here, when you have a system like this, then small particles will burn suspended in the furnace, and bigger particles will follow that parabola and end up here, and then it will be burned while the grate is moving across the boiler. In Thailand, I have seen a rice husk by a boiler using spreader stone, I would say this is not possible. You would need a lot of air. But here you can see here it's combusted air, helping to carry the biomass into the boiler. And this way it would be possible to use the spreader stone system with very fine particles. Something, yes, if you have a boiler with a spreader stoker, the furnace load is much higher. You can talk about how many kilocalories or how many kilowatt hours per cubic meter of furnace or per square meter of brake. And when you use this kind of combustion, you come up much higher than if you only use the chain brake. Another very high furnace load can be achieved if you use air spouts, dust burners. This year, this is quick refiring. When you have this type of combustion, then there will be a lot of fly ash, a lot of the dust, coal or biomass dust will pass up with the flue gas. And then when you have a system like this, you have to put up multi-cyclone, and in the multi-cyclone you collect a lot of ash but also a lot of unburned coal, and the unburned coal will come back here and be sent back into the boiler with air spouts. It's normally called quick refiring, and then you get a higher efficiency of the boiler. You get less unburned carbon in the fly ash. This year, the Babcock and Lincoln bubbling fluidized bed, where you send air into the bottom of the furnace. The whole furnace bottom is sealed, gas-tight membrane, water-cooled walls extended to the bubbling bed, so it's closed, you cannot get air neither in or out. And then you feed air, combustion air, into these pipes, and then it's distributed to those small pipes in jokes. In Europe, you see people sitting from the Far East meditating on a bed of spikes. And this here is almost like a bed of spikes. You have a cap on top of the pipe, and then you press out air, and the air will then keep the whole bed suspended. And you will see a picture of it. It's not good. If you see a picture of it, you'll see you can walk on it. Then so that many pipes with the caps on. Then you feed the biomass of the coal into the fluidized bed with the air swept spouts. So they are both using air both for conveying but also for combustion, for secondary air. And then all the primary air is coming from the bubbling bed.
Yes.
As then removed from here, bubbling fluidized bed boiler. Ash removal, unburned ash should be very low in this kind of boiler. With a bubbling bed, you keep the ash and the bed material in the bottom of the boiler. If you increase the velocity, then you turn into a circulating fluidized bed, then you have to remove fly ash and bed material later on in the boiler. This year, CFP boiler concept with coal firing, where you have different types of fuel. Here they have lime, calcium carbonate. Normally, the same kind of chalk or lime you mix with fodder for animals. And if you do this, then you can minimize or remove the impact of high potassium content in biomass fuel. When you burn biomass with high potassium, then you form clinker gas. But if you add lime, then you remove the clinker gas formation. your ash deformation temperature will come up much higher. So you feed fuel, lime, into the boiler, air supply from the bottom to keep the bottom ash and bed material fluidized, taking ash out from the bed when it gets too high. Up here you have a cyclone where you collect ash and bed materials, and then it's recycled back into the boiler. That's why you call it circulating fluidized bed. This year, this heat exchanger put in the bed material. If you remember when we talked about problems with coconut fiber, potassium chloride eating away super eaters. Here, Foster Wheeler developed a new super eater concept, where you have the superheater embedded in bed material. That means the superheater is no longer exposed to the hot flue gas. The superheater is inside the bed material. Then you can operate with problematic biomass fluids at a much higher superheater temperature. But it demands a CFP boiler. Previously I said CFP boilers, yeah, 50 tons steam or more per hour. But now there's a Chinese boiler manufacturer having license from Foster Wheeler called Wuxi. And Wuxi, they are suggesting to use CFP boiler for 30 tons steam per hour. If you use the steam for power production, then a CFP boiler, you can operate with high pressure and high temperature. That means you can produce electricity about 30% efficiency. 30% of the fuel going in is coming out as electricity. If you use a typical step rate, chain rate setup, you can achieve, you can go to a 40 bar pressure, and you can achieve in the range of 18 to 20% electricity output from the same amount of fuel. These additional 10%, they can pay for quite a lot of investment. And the CFP boiler at 30 tons steam per hour cost, a setup would be like 15% higher investment than for the same rate or traveling weight stove. And the 10% additional electricity can pay back this investment very fast. So don't be too stingy when you are going to invest in a new boiler. You should investigate what are the pros and the cons. For you might have a higher investment, but you can have a higher efficiency. What is the impact on the financial calculation if you go for the higher efficiency but also higher investment? This here is how it works for the reader, the fluidized bed. You have the solids return coming back into the boiler, and then you have the bed material here before it's going back into the furnace. And then you put the superheater into the bed material, and that means you extract a lot of heat from the bed material as well, so it gives quite high efficiency. This year, another combustion technology where you can burn both biomass and coal, Babcock and Wilcox, water cooled vibrating rate. The first empty proof points power plants or coal generation that I heard of was made with this kind of technology. Sabah, the Malaysian part of Borneo. I'm afraid the amplifier is put somebody turned down.
It's working.
Yeah, the Jewish volume.